Oh my goodness, that was exciting. Hi, welcome to, I don't know what number this is of our episodes, but it's always something. We have a new engineer, Joe Cortez is working with us, and thought we had this all worked out, but there's one little button, it's always something small. Don says, I'm just drinking my wine to fill in. I'm not gonna do a wine today, but I'll do it next week. I wanna do something from the Anderson Valley next week. I think it's one of the more unappreciated parts of California. But you know, I just got back last night from England, more than two weeks in England, and it's just been a crazy day. And so I didn't have time to get a wine together. But our guest today is going to be Scott Keyes. Scott Keyes runs a great website. Thank you, Tommy. We're okay. Scott Keyes runs a website called Scott's Cheap Fares. And is Scott with us right now? I don't think quite yet. But let me tell you a little about him. You sign up. It's free. And almost every day you'll get a sampling of fares that are way below what they should be at this time. So he's very good at finding. We're going to ask him how he does it, how he got started, what he sees for airfares coming up in the near future. He's joined us. Hi, Scott. Welcome to the show.
Hey, Rudy.
Sorry to get you in here a little late. We were having just a little bit of a problem. I was just introducing you.
Not at all. Appreciate your working with me here.
Well, nice to have you. Why isn't my light as bright as yours? I don't know. I've got to get it. I'll bring it down while you're talking. I'll leave the screen for a minute when you're talking and just bring it down a little more. Oh, who needs to see my face? It's all about you. So say hello to Scott Keyes. We have some people in who were patiently waited because we were having trouble launching. So we're coming in about 8 minutes late. At any rate, as I said, Scott runs a very popular blog and you can sign up for free and you will receive in your email box fares that are below what they would normally be from point A to point B at that time of the time you receive his email. Scott, let's go way back to the beginning. Tell me a little about you. Where'd you grow up? What'd you do? How did you get into this? Did you have a real job before this? I'm kidding. It's a real job, I know.
I got into this very serendipitously. You know, a lot of entrepreneurs, a lot of startup founders really kind of have their goal to found a startup, to be an entrepreneur. And that was never kind of my background. If it had been, I might have taken maybe a single business class in college or something of the sort. I was actually a journalist. For years in Washington, D.C., I covered political journalism. I would travel and cover all sorts of campaign events.
For whom?
I worked for a now defunct a blog in D.C. called Think Progress. Okay. And then I've done a bunch of freelancing and whatnot since then. But as part of the job, I'd be traveling, you know, to Iowa, to New Hampshire, all over to be able to cover these rallies. And doing that, you know, I was learning a lot about frequent flyer miles. I was learning a lot about airfare. And if you know much about journalism salaries, especially for entry-level journalism jobs, oftentimes they're not especially well compensated. But I had this burning desire to travel. I really wanted to see the world. And so I was trying to figure out, I knew people were getting cheap flights somehow, and I didn't have very much money. How could I, you know, thread this needle? How could I figure out how to be able to see the world on a relatively, you know, meager annual salary? And so getting really into that is how I got my start in the travel world.
And you found, oh, by the way, I do know about starting. I started right out of the day after college, my last college, 2 days after my last college, I got married, drove overnight and started at the Washington Post at $151 a week.
Oh my goodness.
Now, this was 1971 in all fairness. But, you know,
wow. it was probably still the same building. Gosh, I want to say over on 14th Street.
14th Street. No, what you're probably too young to remember the original building.
The
new building has since been torn down.
So I see.
At any rate.
Wow, I didn't realize we had that in common, that old D.C. political or that D.C. journalism background.
No, I was an investigative reporter and scandal monger and gossip columnist at The Washington Post for 11 years and at Washingtonian, the City Magazine, for 9 years before I started doing travel. But like you, I traveled all the time. And I kept learning things. And let me just ask you, when frequent flyer miles were invented, I remember asking friends, hey, are you signed up to get those miles? And they're going, hey, you know, it's like a CB radio craze. It'll last 6 months and it goes away. They'll never be any good. Did you encounter the same sort of resistance?
You know, I actually encountered a lot of internal resistance in the sense that the way that I thought about frequent flyer miles and loyalty programs in general initially was that it was a zero-sum game. And so either the airline wins or the customer wins. And if the customer wins, why would the airlines do this? So why am I going to play in their game and distort my own incentives? So for a long time, I did not do miles. I would not enter any loyalty program. I eventually started to kind of wise up a little bit and start to realize if you, you know, a lot of people are getting the short end of the stick, but if you play it well, if you educate yourself about the system and make sure you're not, falling prey to a few traps, you can really get a ton of value from it.
Okay. Well, that's interesting. I was an early adapter, but and I'll tell you why. I'll tell you why on another webcast. Because by the way, somebody's already asking for your web address, which is Scott's Cheap Flights, right?
ScottsCheapFlights.com. No spaces, no dashes, no apostrophes. You can sign up there.
I'm sorry, Scott. Over you. I was going to say it's Scott's plural without an apostrophe. So it's Scott's Cheap Flights, all one word, scottscheapflights.com. And I'll give it again during the course of our 35 or 40 minutes together.
Perfect.
Okay. So you started paying a little attention to frequent flyer miles and looking for low fares, and you scored a really cheap ticket to Spain, was it? Madrid?
It was to Milan. So this all kind of, I got really into researching, trying to figure out how does airfare work? Why is fares sometimes cheap and sometimes expensive? It all culminated in 2013 when I found the best deal of my life, even to this day. It was a nonstop flight from New York City to Milan on United Airlines for $130 round trip. I could not believe it. My heart was racing. My palms were sweaty. It was one of those fares that I woke up that morning with no intention whatsoever to go to Milan. And I went to bed that night, the proud owner of a $130 round trip flight to Milan. I don't know why that mistake fare popped up. Maybe the airline accidentally left a zero off at the end. Maybe, there's one reason or another why mistake fares like that sometimes pop up. And they don't last very long when they do. And so it's important to act quickly. When I got that deal and took that trip to Milan, I guess word had spread to all my friends and coworkers. And so when I got back, they all kept coming up to me. Hey, Scott, I heard about that great deal you got. Next time you find a deal like that, can you let me know about it so I can get in on it too? Mm-hmm. And so again, when I talk about founding Scott's Cheap Flights in a very serendipitous way, I had no intention of starting a company or founding a business. It was just, I had all these friends who wanted me to let them know next time I found a deal. And so I was like, why don't the simplest way to do this, I'll just start a little email list. Every time I find a deal, I can just send it to this email list. It'll go out to everybody. And so for 18 months, it was just a hobby, something I did for fun, until eventually it got large enough that I started to realize maybe there's a business opportunity here. Started to make that pivot from the journalism world to the travel business world.
That must have been a little scary. It reminds me of the story of Tim and Nina Zagat of the Zagat Guides fame. Mm-hmm. They were living in Paris, both working as lawyers in Paris, both Americans, both living in Paris. But of course, American friends would come over and say, what are the good restaurants? Mm. And they would send out, a letter. I mean, there was no email back in those days. Or they would mimeograph something or photocopy it and give it to them. I don't know. And they did that for several years and said, wait a minute, maybe there's a business in that. And that is how Zagat Guides were born. And that's why they are very, very wealthy, because they sold it for tens of millions of dollars. I mean, they came back to New York, did a New York Zagat Guide, started doing Zagat Guides for the United States. And sold their company for tens of millions of dollars to somebody. I don't know if it was Time Inc. or somebody huge.
Well, it was Edison who said that necessity is the mother of invention. Oftentimes, trying to come up with an idea and force it into existence can be less successful than when the idea just comes to you because you're doing something. People are telling you, I want this. I want those restaurant recommendations. I want those cheap flights. Let me see how, we can make this happen. And then eventually it just kind of builds on itself. I had no intention of starting this company, and I feel very blessed and lucky that I'm sitting here today, having been working on this for 5 years, have a company of 35, 36 people now. It's really, really something.
That is incredible. So how do you find cheap? I mean, how do you find, no matter how many staffers you have, how does anyone find these fares that are basically are anomalies? Their fares shouldn't exist, 360 days a year, maybe. How do you find them? How do you and your team find them?
Airfare is such an interesting thing because it's unlike anything else we buy. I think oftentimes we think of airfare like we're buying, say, a dozen bagels. And when you go buy a dozen bagels, the price of those bagels yesterday is about what the price is today, and that's going to be about what the price is tomorrow. And, you know, if it's yesterday's bagels, they're at a discount. If you, you know, all this and that, we kind of have this mental model of airfare, when in reality, airfare behaves not at all like that. The price yesterday is oftentimes nothing like the price today, and the price today is often nothing like the price tomorrow. And rather than it being the price being contingent on how many bagels you buy, oftentimes with flights, it is way cheaper to fly further. You know, it is cheaper usually to fly to Barcelona from New York, say, than it is to fly from New York to my home airport of Dayton. And you'd think, wow, how could that be? But it, you know, it gets into very, not super complicated, but it gets into a lot of minutia of having that if you want to travel, if you want to go overseas, you need a flight. There's no, you know, there's no realistic other way to get to Europe, to get to Asia. And so people need this thing, but they have no idea what it's supposed to cost, where, you know, what it's going to be tomorrow. If I wait, will it go up or down? So it's a unique, really kind of headache and just stressor for a lot of people. And so what we've found is that if you just constantly are paying attention, if you are, rather than just searching, you know, once here or there, just taking a little snapshot, if instead you're searching 10, 15, 20 hours a day, constantly monitoring, and then when the airfare drops, when it goes down, you, that's when you're buying, that's when you're alerting folks, hey, these flights to Barcelona just popped up really cheap.
Do you have an algorithm that you guys use that identify them for you? I can't imagine everybody sitting there looking for, you know, New York to Dayton, New York to Madrid or Milan constantly.
It's a mix. It's a mix of stuff. So a large part of it is really built on that kind of human elbow grease, just a matter of kind of searching constantly. I mean, you'd be surprised how much expertise you can develop at using Google Flights and other flight search engines in a very efficient and effective manner. One of the reasons, for instance, why I love Google Flights is rather than most flight search engines where you have to put in one airport to one destination airport and you get one date pairs. With Google Flights, you can search seven origin airports to seven destination airports across the entire calendar, and it'll show you the cheapest single route of those 49 possibilities. And so you can see how, if you are a power user of Google Flights, the tools that they have built have made it much more possible to be able to find those little diamonds in the rough in a way that even 5 or 10 years ago would have been taken, you know, hours and hours of manual searching. It's become much more possible because of today's technologies.
Celeste asked if you do both domestic and international flights, and I think I can confidently say the answer is yes.
Yes. So we hadn't done domestic flights until this summer. We did do flights to Hawaii, Alaska, Puerto Rico, but we didn't really do lower 48 states. And the reason why was that those fares in general tend to be lower to begin with. And for me, I was really excited about the types of fares like that Milan deal I got, where it was $130 round trip and, you know, $700 off of normal prices, what you would normally expect to pay for that. And if you have a normal domestic fare that costs $300 or $350 to begin with, you can't save $700 unless the airline, you know, gives you a free ticket and a check for $350 alongside it. So that's why I kind of dug my heels in a little bit. But obviously during the pandemic, a lot of folks looking, to the extent that folks are traveling, keeping their focus much more domestic now, we realized, yes, let's really make this happen. And for a lot of folks, even when they're traveling domestically, even if they know they can't save $500-$600 off their flights, they still want to get the best fare possible. They still don't want to overpay. And we want to make sure that that's possible for them.
When I do speeches and I'm speaking generally to an audience, I say, look, one of the most common mistakes travelers make is finding a good fare. And instead of booking it right then, at least a good fare to them, is they feel they have to go to the office the next day, bounce it off four different people, call their brother in Kansas and say, you think it's a pretty good fare? What do you think? And then they go back to the computer that night, 24 hours later, 12 hours later, and the fare is not there. So which leads to the question, Michael, one of our viewers asked, once you see a cheap fare, do you jump on it or wait a short time to see if the price will drop more?
Let me give you a little story. A few years ago, I found one of these mistake fares where the airline accidentally sells it for way less than they meant to. It was from the US to India for about $200 round trip. I think it was on Emirates Airlines, one of the best airlines in the world. I could not believe it. So I pinged my friend. I said, hey, should we get this? And we spent the next 2 hours planning out an itinerary, making plans and everything before we bought those tickets. I kid you not, 30 seconds before I went to book the $200 flight to India, it disappeared. And I mean, 5 years later, it's still one of those deals that irks me. Just I cannot forget it. So what I recommend is, especially when you have one of these mistake fares, one of these ones that's in really incredible price, booking it sooner rather than later, not expecting that it's going to last very long. In general, there's a rule that I call the hotcakes principle. The better the deal, the shorter it's going to last. And so what the one piece of advice that I think I would really recommend to folks is remembering about what's called the 24-hour rule. Under U.S. federal law, if you book a flight directly with the airline, so not through, you know, a Priceline or Expedia, something like that, directly through the airline, as long as your flight is at least a week out from travel, you are guaranteed 24 hours from the moment you hit purchase. It's a grace period of 24 hours where you can cancel and get your entire purchase back, no fees, no penalties whatsoever.
I didn't know it had to be a week out. I thought it could be the next day.
Some of the airlines do the policy a little bit different. Some will say, oh, you know, it can be 3 days out. Sometimes there's, you know, if you get a nice agent, they'll work, they'll make an exception for you. My understanding, the regulation from the Department of Transportation says the bare minimum is as long as it's 1 week out, then they have to do this, the airlines. And so what that means is if you have this 24-hour grace period, rather than, you know, you see this mistake fare, $200 round trip to India, rather than waiting for your wife to get home for, you know, to make those plans later, waiting for your husband to get out of his meeting and then see what dates work, book it right then. And what you've done is you haven't said, oh, I'm, you know, this money is long gone. What you've done is you've locked in the price for 24 hours. And then you can take those 24 hours to decide, to plan an itinerary, to see, yes, do we want this or no? You know, if you decide I don't want it, then you can cancel, get your full money back without any penalty, without any fee, and be no worse for the wear. So, you know, if you wait, oftentimes you're risking the deal, unfortunately, disappearing.
Excellent advice. I guess because I live in Minneapolis, St. Paul, where Delta rules the roost, to put it mildly. And they do have, I mean, every time you book a ticket, it actually comes up on the screen saying, remember, you can go and buy this because you have 24 hours to change. So that's one good thing about living in a fortress city as we are with in St. Paul and Minneapolis, the Twin Cities with Delta. Yazil asks, are short-term super low fares put out there by employees of airlines for their friends and families? I don't think they're posted publicly is the quick answer to that, I think, right?
Yeah, I mean, there are like certain types of fares that can exist either when they're sold through an agency that's then kind of not on the sort of a public market like you would see if you're booking through Kayak or searching on Google Flights or elsewhere. I mean, there are like little instances of that. Generally speaking, though, I would not expect that to be a cause of most mistake fares, you know, a cause of when the fare is really high and then goes really, really low. There are a myriad of reasons why airfare, you know, will be at one price today and then a different price later today and a third price tomorrow morning. And I would generally expect that to be much more about competition with other airlines, the price of oil, what type of demand they're seeing from customers, and much less about maybe one rogue employee in the revenue department trying to do a solid for a friend. I think that's probably generally less likely.
All right. I'm going to ask you in a minute about what to look into the crystal ball and what do you see coming up for the spring and the summer. But first, let's talk about today. I mean, there are as one of our viewers just mentioned, there are countries like Croatia that was open until I think this last week to Americans. Croatia just closed its borders. But as we all know, except for me, I'm allowed to go to England to see my granddaughters. It's amazing because continental Europe is all shut down. We're on the, as I often say, the Americans are on the don't invite them list. Yet we still have airlines still flying there because they're either required to keep their slots at those stations and so on. Are airlines offering really seductive fares for some of those to try to just get anybody on the plane who might be have a European passport and could get in, for example, to France or Germany or Italy at times?
Basically not. You might think like, oh yeah, you know, the fares would be really, really cheap. But the reason why there's not been very good fares to Europe lately is that there's just not nearly as much competition between airlines. And competition between airlines is the single biggest driver of why you might see cheap flights on a specific route. And that's the reason why, you know, flying from New York to Dayton is not often a cheap route because there's not a ton of airlines flying that. Whereas New York to Barcelona is very, you know, there's a ton of competition on that. And so you see them trying to undercut one another on price. There are, you mentioned, yes, airlines have to what's called protect their slots. They have to fly a certain amount in order to still be able to hold on to a landing slot at certain airports. There's also categories of folks who are still traveling, even if tourists aren't generally allowed. You mentioned EU passport holders, family members of folks who are living in Europe, significant others. Many countries will let in significant others who aren't necessarily married. Students are often allowed. And even folks who are transiting the EU to a country where they are allowed. So, you know, rewind 2 weeks ago, let's say you're going to Croatia. You could take a flight to Paris as long as you held that ticket onward to Croatia, whereas you could not take that flight just to Paris and then get off and go explore France. And so without as much competition, the fares have not been as good to Europe today as they were a year ago. A year ago, you would regularly see flights from the US to Paris, to Amsterdam, elsewhere, under $350 round trip. Common to see that. And believe you me, that would have been shocking if you had told me that 5 years ago, that in 2019, we would regularly see flights to Europe under $350 round trip. We're not seeing those quite as much today, but I think those are the types of fares that I would expect to resume once travel's resuming to normal after the pandemic is in the rearview mirror.
That is why we are paying you the big bucks to do this show, to do this webcast with us, Scott. The future. Mm. All right. So some people are all excited because there are some shots you can take soon or in the next few months that will reportedly alleviate the chance of you getting COVID. But it hasn't happened yet. We don't know when those of us who are not working on the front lines or aren't 81 or over or whatever are going to be allowed to have those vaccines. So you're predicting there are going to be a lot of sales when airlines start flying more routes and people can travel to get people to make that big step again that they haven't made for 10 months, 12 months.
Absolutely.
13 months, whatever.
Absolutely. Good. Yes.
That's good to hear.
Yeah. I think that, you know, look, everybody that has been enduring this awful 2020, has been wanting to travel, but has been following public health advice and trying to stay safe and not take undue risk, is going to want to be making up for lost time next year. You know, taking those trips that we put on pause, put on ice this year, and taking them next summer. And so for a lot of folks, you know, there might be a worry, almost a concern, that with everybody wanting to travel all of a sudden, does that mean that with the law of supply and demand that we're going to see higher fares, right? Here's why I don't think that's going to necessarily be the case. First of all, supply is going to significantly increase, and in this case, supply of flights. There are two main causes of that. One is that a lot of airlines still have thousands of planes parked in the desert in Arizona and California and elsewhere that are just basically sitting there waiting for demand to pick back up. And so it's going to be easy for the airlines to meet that demand for travel pretty quickly because those airplanes are just sitting there ready to fly again. And second, I'm sure you've heard about the news about the 737 MAX just getting reapproved in the US and elsewhere. That there are, you know, hundreds and hundreds, if not thousands, of those planes that are going to be ready to enter the supply here pretty soon, especially in early 2021. And so when you're going to see a lot of capacity from the airlines meeting that demand, The second thing, though, that's important here as well is that even though a lot of folks, myself included, will be very comfortable traveling, you know, once that vaccine is shown safe, effective, and widely available, there are going to be a lot of folks who might be a little wary at first, who might, you know, be taking their time, not sure, we'll see. And so rather than it being what's called, you know, a V-shaped recovery, I expect it to be more of a Nike swoosh recovery, where you think it goes down quickly and then slowly, gradually starts to pick back up. And for the airlines,
swoosh might start going up early summer?
In terms of the demand? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think summer 2021 is when, in my head, I'm imagining that a lot of folks are going to be really trying to you know, visit Europe, make up for those trips that they'd missed out on this year, be able to take, you know, visit family and elsewhere. Kind of late spring, early summer is when I expect to really see the gas get pumped there. And so I think on average, the fares might go up from compared to where they are today. But the important thing to remember is that you don't buy average fares, you buy available fares. And so rather than thinking about it, oh, on average, it might be a little bit higher. But remember, we talked earlier about volatility. You're not buying, don't buy the flights when they're $1,300 to Europe, even if that'll distort the average upward. Buy them when they're $400 to Europe, buy them when they're $350 to Europe, because those do pop up all the time. And that's what, you know, we're doing at SCF, at Scholarship Flights, is letting folks know, alerting members to when it is in that more bare bottom pricing rather than a really kind of high elevated one. But the last thing I'll note there is, again, we mentioned that a lot of folks aren't going to be initially comfortable traveling, getting on planes. It'll take a little while. What's the single biggest lever that the airlines have to try to get folks back on the skies, back on the planes? It's cutting the fares. It's slashing the fares for travelers. You know, in normal times, the price is by far the most important factor in their purchasing decisions. During the pandemic, that has switched to safety and comfort. But once, you know, the pandemic's in the rearview mirror and people feel safe and comfortable traveling again, price is going to reemerge as the number one factor. And so airlines will be competing on that. And then you can see anticipate a bunch of sales to entice travelers to travel again.
You know, I have a particular interest in this because in 2018, I started a tour company for small tours to Europe. And we had all kinds of people booked for 2019. 90% of them have kindly, for 2020, excuse me, started in 2019, and then had a lot of people for this year. They most kindly switched into 2021. But even that, where I think our first tour is May, except for we're doing a Napa weekend in early April, I think, mid-April. But otherwise, everything's over in Europe. It starts in May. And one of our guests, Danielle, just said, recent announcement from Rick Steves, my buddy Rick, said his tours, he's looking at August 2021 or later for tour booking. So it's a crapshoot, isn't it? It really is. You ask, when I get your newsletter, which is do you try to publish every day?
So what we do is, you know, I've taken during the pandemic to writing an advice newsletter. Think of it like a column every week with sort of actionable advice for travelers, how to interpret the news, whether it is, you know, how to travel safely, whether it's what does the cabin air quality look like, whether it's how to get a refund from an airline during the COVID pandemic, that type of stuff. But then for the actual deals, it's just totally dependent on what fares pop up. Some days there's only one or two deals that pop up. Some days we'll have just a rush of them. We kind of very purposely did not set a quota because our focus wants to be solely on quality, and it's up to the airlines what fares they're going to offer
when they're available. But I note on almost all of them, you'll say, I expect this fare to maybe not last longer than 24 hours. So, you know, if you're interested in it, get serious now. Is that, well, I guess that goes back to our earlier conversation, but if you see a fare that you think is a good price, don't try to outguess, you know, the airline and think, well, it's going to drop $50 by next Wednesday. Yeah. If it's a good price to you and you really want to go ahead and take it. And I guess that would be the same advice to the fares that you send out to those of us who subscribe to Scott's Cheap Flights.
Yeah. So two thoughts on that. One is that bad fares tend to be relatively stable. You'll see them sticking around pretty pretty evenly. And so you don't have to worry as much that the fare is going to jump or go down. But the good fares, again, we talked about the hotcakes principle, the better the fare, the shorter it tends to last. And so that's why, you know, it doesn't matter. We don't get a commission. It doesn't matter to us if people book a flight or not, but we want to be, you know, sort of your travel expert who's a friend and give you as good of advice as possible about how long we think it's going to last. But the second thing that I would note here is that airlines often engage in what's called a fare war with one another. You know, we mentioned competition between airlines being the single biggest driver of cheap flights. I remember talking with a subscriber earlier this year, Donald. Donald lived in Washington, D.C. and wanted to travel over to Japan. So we sent him a deal. It was D.C. to Vietnam for about $600 round trip. He's like, okay, Vietnam sounds amazing. That's a great price. I'm going to book it. He booked it. And then 6 hours later, we found a deal from Richmond, just outside of D.C., to Japan for $650. And he was like, oh, great, because that's really where I wanted to go. And so, again, he was within the 24-hour period. He booked that Richmond to Japan flight and then canceled his flight from D.C. to Vietnam. Wouldn't, as luck would have it, again, competition between airlines, this fare war, right after about 4 hours later, a flight popped up from D.C. to Japan for $500. And so again, he just did the same thing, booked the flight from D.C. to Japan, canceled his Richmond to Japan one, got his full money back, and was the proud owner of a cheap flight to Japan. And so oftentimes, locking in the fare, but then still kind of keeping an eye on things over the next 24 hours, because that's when you have that grace period to be able to cancel without any penalty. And you can still be able to get a better deal if the airlines compete with one another and keep ratcheting down the fare.
I think it's important to mention, I should have mentioned it in your introduction, that you are not a booking website per se. You don't go to Scott's Scott's links to book a flight. He will tell you where to book a flight or how to search for it most easily. Good question from Mark. He asks if you deal in business class. Do you only do coach fares? Do you only do rock bottom coach fares? If a first or business class fare becomes available, do you flag it for us?
Yeah. So right now, when there's a really good business fare class, so a month or two ago, we found one to the Azores from the East Coast for about $650 round trip in business class. One of my favorite fares actually in recent memory was a mistake fare from all over the West Coast to all over West Coast of the U.S. to all over Southeast Asia, Bangkok, Bali, Vietnam for about $550 round trip, again, in business class. One of the best deals of recent memory.
What airline was that on? Scott, do you remember what airline that was on?
That was on Hong Kong Airlines. Not an airline that many folks have heard of, but they're actually a four-star airline, have a great business class product, very, very comfortable, lie flat seats, you know, great food, great champagne. I felt like half of my coworkers ended up booking that deal and traveling to Thailand and Vietnam and elsewhere. I would have gotten in myself, except for my wife and I were expecting a child about 2 months later. And we're like, I don't think we can justify this. But otherwise, we would have done that deal.
That's not a good enough reason. Baby, for goodness sake.
Well, listen, if that deal comes up again, we're going to be on it, believe you me. And so when those really good business class fares pop up, we absolutely send them out. But right now we focus just on these sort of exceptionally good business class ones. We're hoping to try to branch out into sort of larger business class fares. But the thing to remember is that a really good business class fare to Europe is going to be, you know, just a shade under $2,000. And really good business class fare to Asia is going to be a shade under $3,000. And so obviously that's still a relatively expensive flight compared to what you can get in economy. But there are a lot of folks who are interested in that, who maybe they're tall or you know, have means or older, and like, you know, I deserve this. I can treat myself.
Those are good fares for business class to Europe and to Asia. I mean, they're perfectly legitimate. You can pay easily $4,000 on the average day to Europe and $5,000 to Asia. You're not taking advantage of those Asian fares because your baby was coming. I mentioned I just got back last night from England, where my family just moved from London to Brighton. So I was in Brighton anyway. These two granddaughters are 9 and 12, and I was actually there 6 weeks ago for a couple of weeks. And last time I was there, my 9-year-old or 10-year-old said, you know, can you stay one more week? And I said, well, you know, I've got this round trip ticket and it's a really good fare. And she just, I mean, I told my daughter, take her out of primary school, put her into law school right now, fire back. Remember, are you putting an air ticket, airfare in front of in front of your two granddaughters?
Oh, oh.
Dagger to my heart. What a shallow guy I am. I mean, the answer is yes. I can't afford to buy one ticket for the, you know. Anyway, okay. So if you've just tuned in, well, you can see at the top, my guest is Scott Keys of Scott's Cheap Flights. You can get rid of that apostrophe in Scott's and just put it all together, scottscheapflights.com, and you will receive his newsletter. And I find the fare is just because I, you know, like you follow things in the travel business. I love watching your fares and going, whoa. And often I can't take up on them. Not that anybody's having my baby, thank goodness, but.
You'd be surprised how often we hear that from members who say, you know, even though I can't travel as much as I would like to, it still brings me a lot of joy to do window shopping because it makes it much more realistic that, hey, when I do have time, I can get, you know, a $350 flight to Paris. I can get a $400 flight to Tokyo rather than expecting to have to pay $1,000 or $2,000 to be able to visit those places.
You get smarter. You find out what the, David asks if you ever spot any good fares to South America and report on them.
Oh, absolutely. The mistake fares that we found a couple weeks ago, a mistake fare when an airline accidentally sells a fare for way less than they meant to. We found ones all over South America, Lima, Santiago, Buenos Aires, Panama City, elsewhere, for incredibly cheap. The best one was Atlanta to Santiago for $63 round trip on Delta, nonstop flight.
Is that a fat-fingered mistake?
That was an absolute mistake. Okay. I flew that route actually 10 years ago when I did study abroad in Santiago and I paid close to $1,000. And it was one of my cheap flight regrets that I paid that much. But again, to see that now it's $63 and we had hundreds and hundreds of members who took advantage who are taking that flight. And they're all really excited because we've passed the window now where when a mistake fare happens, you always, after you book, you want to give it a week or two just in case the airline decides not to honor it. 85 to 90% of the time they do honor it, but you want to wait a little bit to make sure, you know, to see we've passed that window now. People have taken some of these flights and they're traveling throughout 2021 on these $63 flights. So everybody's really ecstatic who got in on that deal.
I wish you'd call me on these things, guys.
You got to keep your email open. Get that alert.
I do. Sometimes airlines, if it makes the news, airlines will let everybody take the fare because it's great publicity for them. And sometimes airlines take the hard case. Go, hey, that was a mistake. We're not giving you that. Don't even think about it. One person asked if you take PayPal. Well, as I said, Scott is not a booking flight. He doesn't sell you the ticket. So don't worry about PayPal. You got to deal with your airline or, you know, the airline website or a third party website, wherever you go to buy. Michael asks, well, it's a good question if you don't know the answer. How exactly does an airline make a mistake cheap fare?
It's a great question. So there are a number of different possibilities that can cause a mistake fare. One of them is just what I call a fat finger discount. Maybe they meant to sell that ticket for $630 to Santiago and they left off a zero at the end. And so it went 63. Another issue sometimes could be a currency conversion error. Rewind about 10 years ago, one of the best mistake fares in first class was a deal out of Myanmar when overnight the government there decided to devalue the currency by a factor of about 600 or 700 fold. And so what happened was a fare that had cost $10,000 the night before all of a sudden cost $100 or $150 just because of the overnight currency devaluation. Sometimes there'll be an error in transmission between, you know, you can buy a Delta ticket not only on Delta.com, but you can buy it on Kayak. You can buy it on AirFrance.com. There are hundreds, if not thousands of different places you can buy it. Sometimes something gets lost in transmission. The one that's sneaky is every once in a while, an airline will do a mistake fare where they claim to accidentally have discounted it. Yeah, I don't know if you remember Independence Air, based in DC, used to load, you know, incredibly cheap fares at midnight, 10, 20 bucks, wherever they were flying. They would load them up at midnight. Then they would call the travel desk at the Washington Post and be like, oh, you never know what you might find at flyeye.com. This airline no longer exists, so I guess this strategy didn't work well for them. But, you know, there are any number of these factors. Because it's a mistake, there are any number of reasons why that mistake might have come to pass. But the key is that because it's a mistake, it tends not to last very long, and you have to book it before the airline fixes it. Otherwise, you know, you're just out of luck. On to the next one.
Well, Scott, I've learned a lot today. Thank you. Let me remind our viewers that I'm doing this every other week now, as opposed to every week, because I've gotten a little busier in some other things. But I'm delighted to be here today. I'm going to do a couple short travel news items in just a moment as I say goodbye to Scott. But Scott, I appreciate you taking time out of your afternoon. You're down in, where are you, North Carolina? Where are you?
So I live out in Portland, Oregon. Grew up in Ohio, and now migrated by the way out west.
I'm sorry. My new engineer is on the East Coast. I'm sorry. You're out west. Well, good for you. One Washington, you're close to the other Washington now. Thank you for your wisdom. Thanks for putting this for your work on this and putting these fares out there, because most of us, all of us, don't have the time to do what you do. So I really appreciate it, Scott. Thank you,
Rudy. It's such a pleasure. The pleasure is all mine to be speaking with such a travel icon and trailblazer like yourself. I can't tell you what a joy this is. So thank you not only for the opportunity but for all you've done.
Yes, I'm old, Scott. I admit it. Thank you.
All right, thank you. I appreciate you, Rudy. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Okay, just a couple of travel news tidbits. If you get my newsletter, you will have seen some of these. If you don't, just go to maxatours.com and scroll down to the bottom page. You can sign up for free. I'm going to be doing that every other week as well. If you like staying in Kimpton hotels, between now and Valentine's Day, they have a secret word or secret phrase that if you use it, you'll be given immediately right at the front desk some fabulous treat, like a room upgrade, could be free parking, could be a couple of drinks in the house. That phrase is lift your spirits. So if there's a Kimpton hotel in your future between now and Valentine's Day, just remember when you check in to say the phrase lift your spirits mean anything to you. And it will. And British Airways has joined the cavalcade of airlines that are selling their cutlery and their coffee pots and champagne flutes and blankets and casserole dishes and slippers and even their carts, their drink carts to the public. So if you want to set your entire table with British Airways first class branded cutlery and crockery, well, check it out at British Airways. The exact website is on my newsletter. You can, but I'm sure you can find it through the British Airways site, or just search British Airways selling silverware, and you'll probably find it on Google. And the FCC this week again put the kibosh on the possibility of people being able to use cell phones on planes. They said pilots don't want it, people don't want it, we're not approving it. England shortened their 14-day quarantine requirement as of December 15th. You only have to go for 5 days if, when you arrive from the United States, you take a COVID test 5 days after landing and it proves negative for the virus. So keep that in mind if you're going there. And LaGuardia is offering free COVID-19 tests to both arriving and departing passengers. Free COVID tests. It's on the first floor of Terminal B at LaGuardia. I landed in Kennedy yesterday afternoon coming back from London. And in the Delta terminal, they were also offering free COVID tests as well. And, you know, I hate to say this because I know when we did a webcast not long ago on cruises, and it was very popular. It's gotten almost the highest number of hits on YouTube as any of our webinars. I know a lot of people are into cruising and want to think about cruising, but I got to tell you, it looks like a lot of cruise lines are just going to shut down for 2021. Maybe offer some Christmas market tours in December of late November, early December of next year. But if you're looking forward to a cruise in 2021, don't count on it. Now, you know, as you know, everything in the travel world these days, in the whole world these days, changes all the time. You can't go to New York. You can't go to New York. You can go to, you know, you can go to England if you quarantine for 14 days. Now, as of December 15th, it's 5 days. Anyway, so you can hold me to that today, that prediction, but we'll see if it turns out to be true. All right. Going every other week. I saw one of these. Oh, no, tell me you're not going every other week. Hard to get an interesting guest. I mean, it's not hard, but it requires a bit of work and takes some time to arrange and so on. But I really appreciate your joining me here today. Delighted to have you in the house. We'll do it again in 2 weeks. And meanwhile, stay well. And I hope we'll be traveling together again soon, if not on one of my tours, on any tour, on any plane, on any train, on any Greyhound bus, or in any car, because so many of us I know miss traveling. Thanks for joining me. Talk to you in a couple of weeks. As you know, you can find, if there's some stuff you learned during this webcast that you think would be interesting to someone you know, in about 24 hours, it should be up on YouTube. Just type in Rudy Maxa and Scott Keyes, K-E-Y-E-S, and it'll come up, and you can forward it, the link to your friend. All our past ones are up there as well. And again, the newsletter is at maxatours.com. Scroll down to the bottom, fill in your name, your email, and you will receive that every other week. And it's news and chat. And I do a little personal essay stuff. My favorite restaurants in LA right now, well, not now, but in normal times, or in Paris or whatever. Feel free to subscribe to the newsletter. Delighted to have you there, and delighted to have you aboard today. All right. We'll see you in a couple of weeks. Take care. Bye-bye.